Atheist Nomads, episode 148. News for May 26, 2016.
The podcast you're about to listen to includes cursing and talking about hoo-haws. Please be advised.
We are the Atheist Nomads, bringing you history, science, politics, religion, and interviews with leaders in the atheist community. Not all those who wander are lost. Welcome to another episode of Atheist Nomads. I am Dustin. Joining me as always is Wesley.
Hello, everybody.
And joining us once again is my lovely wife, Lauren.
Hello, everyone.
You know, so apparently it's expected of me to actually say that because I get comments now. I have catchphrase.
It is pretty routine of you.
Wait, I've heard it so many times. I
has catchphrase. Yeah, it's awesome. Hello, everybody.
Oh, wow. Okay. May, I said 26th, right?
Yes.
This is for May 26th.
Yeah.
I forgot to update something for the video. Yes, for those of you... I cannot multitask.
Wow, no, he cannot.
For those of you listening, you can also catch this on YouTube. And those of you on YouTube, you just saw me fix it. Most of it, crap. There we go. Now the note at the bottom down below
now is correct.
Okay, episode, so any date. News, anybody?
News? We're here for news.
Anything new?
I bent the rim on my motorcycle. That kind of sucked. But hooray for Facebook. I'm part of a giant motorcycle group there. And I was asking for recommendations on a cheap one. Yeah, yes. Fucking A.
Facebook motorcycle gang.
Yeah, we're Hex Angels. Yeah, totally. I was asking for recommendations and somebody's actually just sending me a new rim. So saving me hundreds of dollars.
Nice.
That is so cool.
Yeah, the rim he took off his bike is getting shipped to me. All I have to do is pay for shipping. So,
that's really cool. A.
And Lauren, anything new with you?
Allergies all in my face. I put on makeup because there was so much allergies. It made me look like I was 40.
Wow.
And you aren't.
No.
No.
I'm
only
not.
39.
30, not 9.
31. It's okay.
Okay.
I'm not one of those ladies.
All right. So for me, this was really fresh news with our last news episode, but I wanted to wait for hearing some better analysis since it is involving a 500-page government bureaucratic document. But the FDA on May 10 issued the deeming regulations declaring chewing tobacco, cigars, and e-cigs and vaporizing devices to be tobacco products.
Right.
Oh.
What this means is anything that wasn't on the market by February of 2007, back when vaping wasn't a thing in the U.S.
Basically everything then.
Will have 2 years, a 2-year compliance window, to apply for a pre-market authorization.
Right.
Pre-market tobacco authorization. Since those started in 2010, the FDA has only approved one. And they've had hundreds of applications. They've approved one. So that's not good. The standards to get approved on one of those is that you have to, A, prove that, well, document every single detail of what's involved in the manufacturing process, every single ingredient. You have to do a bunch of chemical analysis. Okay, that part I don't have a problem with.
Right, manufacturing regulation.
You have to prove that it will not be a harm to general public health.
Okay.
I don't know how you can do that with anything. You can't even prove that tap
water. Put a sticker on it?
Yeah. Is not going to be a harm to general public health.
everything is toxic in sufficient quantities.
And you have to prove that it is not going to be attractive to children.
That's a tough one for the vapor industry.
Especially since humans like sweet flavors.
Sweet, fruity.
Whether they are adult humans or child humans, they like sweet flavors. Well, that is just part of being a primate.
It sure is handy that, you know, Joe Camel and all the rest of them, you know, made all their cigarette brands well before 2007.
Yes.
Yeah. Including all that chewing tobacco and other products that are finally been deemed tobacco.
Yeah.
Or nicotine or whatever related.
So it's a great way to get rid of vaping and B, a great way to get rid of any new startups.
Mm-hmm. So the FDA,
all of the startups,
while going through this review process prior to releasing the official rules, the head of the Center for Tobacco
Cessation,
whatever it is, group at the FDA, he acknowledged that vaping was good for an improvement for public health.
Okay.
Better than cigarettes and good for public health. So, okay, that seemed like good news. But the FDA has admitted that this regulation will put 99% of all vaping businesses out of business, destroy 99% of the industry, and they say that it will spur innovation.
No. When you kill 99% of an industry, there's no innovation. Uh-huh. It just kills it.
Yeah.
You know what? People in a garage who are innovating just don't have $5 million laying around.
No. Dustin sure doesn't.
If you want innovation, you want small businesses, you want competition. If you want a properly FDA regulated industry, even putting tobacco under the FDA was stupid. Absolutely stupid.
Well, it does count as a drug.
The point of the FDA is to make sure that healthy things are safe. Putting them in charge of something that they are inherently against,
that is toxic to begin with,
is stupid. Let the ATF take care of it.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That's what it's there
for.
That's
true.
If they put vaping under the ATF, that would have been a lot better.
Or at least make more sense. Tobacco is under the FDA as well?
Yeah. Now.
What is the point of having the big T in tobacco if they're not including all of the tobacco products?
Yeah, I don't know.
I guess it's a tiny T.
All tobacco products now are under FDA authority.
Oh.
So I don't know what the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms and Explosives, what they deal with tobacco now.
They're just going to be the AF.
Speaking of the tea and the vaping, you're making a really cool cloud effect on the YouTube video.
Yeah, this is intentional. I went with my bigger cloud tank.
Good thing I'm not allergic to it.
Yeah, well, anyway, let's get back to this rant. So they are going to be wiping out the vaping industry. What has the potential, because all the evidence as it's come out to this point, it is far safer than traditional cigarettes. It is more effective at getting people off of cigarettes than any conventional smoking cessation products. The Royal College of Physicians in Britain actually recently came out and said vaping is awesome. It is much safer than smoking, and it needs to be encouraged by the government.
I kind of feel like this is going to be seriously challenged over the next 2 years.
There's already been one lawsuit filed. And there are several more being planned. What I ask of you for support. I don't have the most amenable of congressional representation.
They basically
here.
Told him to fuck off.
Yeah. When I wrote them about it before, they said basically, yeah, fuck off. but you, all of you, might have better people than our stupid fucktard Mormon asswipes in Congress, and ask them to support the Bishop Cole Amendment. It is an amendment to the 2017 Agriculture Appropriations Bill. It would change the grandfather date for vapor products to the effective date of the regulations, so August 10, 2016. And it would also add in some additional regulations that the FDA hasn't put in, like not allowing vending machines and ensuring that you have warning labels on, better warning labels on products. I don't remember all the rules they had in there, but they had stuff to actually, some actual good regulations.
They actually made sense. I remember he read through them to me earlier. I'm like, as a non-vapor, I'm like, that makes sense. So yeah, he's really passionate about this stuff. And even if you don't vape, you probably know somebody who does. Just as even as non-vapers, send in your support.
Yeah,
to your local rep so that he'll still have his vape.
This is what got me off of cigarettes 4 years ago.
And he's not going back.
Without that, Lauren and I would have never gotten together.
Mm. Yeah, and if you were to go back, that would be bad. I mean, I wouldn't probably leave you, but...
So, yes, please write your congresspeople so that I don't have to go back to smoking the stinkies and piss off my wife.
Yeah.
Think of the puppies.
Yeah. All right. So now that we got that covered, what do you have for this day in history?
Oh, boy. Well, this day in history, May 26th. Let's start with the year 1857. Dred Scott is emancipated by the Blow family, his, well, original owners. So you might have heard about this really old gent named Dred Scott, a black guy who...
Well, some of you. Apparently Idaho public schools don't.
Yeah, apparently Idaho public schools suck.
But... Enlighten me.
And I actually argued this case in government class.
Holy shit. I should have you give this.
Didn't you have AP government?
No. Oh. No, this is just normal government.
Maybe that was my problem.
Okay, so let's see. He was an enslaved black guy in the United States who actually unsuccessfully sued for his freedom. How weird does that sound? you might have heard of the Dred Scott versus Sanford case, which that happened in 1857. And yeah, he sued to have his wife and his children become free because they lived in the state, well, the area, the Wisconsin territory, which didn't have slavery. And yeah, it was kind of weird that Missouri, which is where he lived for a very long time as a slave, Missouri had a precedent dating back it was like 28 years, that if a slave lived in a free state for a long time, they had a doctrine known as once free, always free. And, you know, if they lived in a free state for a long time, came back, they should be, well, technically free.
Mm-hmm.
And
makes sense.
Yeah. And well, his owners didn't see it that way.
Why did he go back? One, and two, he died only a year after the case. That sucks.
Well, yeah, I mean, you can't really stop him getting sick. I believe it was tuberculosis that he died from.
Oh.
Which, you know, completely
But he got
sucked.
It for his children's.
Yeah. He was... What was the first part of the question?
Sorry, it was... If you lived in a free state, why would you go back to a slave state with the possibility of having to be a slave again?
His owners...
Or at least not getting citizenship.
Well, his owners called for him to come back, and he and his family, he and his wife did.
Well, he was with his owners in Illinois.
And they went back on the... They went back first and asked
and then
them
he
to come
found
back
out,
later.
And then he got down there and was like, wait a minute, I should be free.
Yeah.
Everybody else got to be free.
Yeah. So, yeah, poor guy. I mean, he even tried to buy his freedom and his wife's freedom for $300, which in today's money, I think is close to $8,000. So I'm sure that took a fuckload of time for him to save that amount of money up.
Although my understanding is going rate for a slave was roughly the equivalent of $20,000 today.
Fuck.
Yeah. So it was actually, that was a paltry amount.
But... probably closer to $30,000 now. About the price of a new car.
Man.
Well, those rickshaws aren't going to drive themselves.
That is true.
We need rickshaw taxis in Boise. Anyway.
If you can try. Yeah, like I said, he actually sued for his family's freedom, and a lower court actually granted that. But his owners bumped it up the ladder and, well, kept him for themselves for a while longer.
Did he ever gain his actual citizenship?
That was an actual part of that ruling, and when his owners got to keep him, is saying basically that slaves were never actually citizens, so they didn't really have a right to sue. So that was kind of fucked up of the Supreme Court. Mm-hmm. But Justice Hamilton R. Gamble, who was later appointed governor of the state of Missouri, sharply disagreed with the majority decision, which was a 7-2 decision. And he wrote the dissenting opinion, which was kind of cool, I suppose. So, yeah. Luckily, towards the end of his life, his owners finally gave him up and let him and his family be free. Man, yeah, really fucked up.
That was messed up.
But, you know, this trial really kind of set the tone for a lot of other slaves to come, and you know, actually helped bring slavery and, not having slaves into the forefront, and you know, showed how fucked up a lot of their lives were. So,
yeah. Well, yeah, I guess so. So, kind of a silver lining there.
Yeah.
Kind of.
Kind of, yeah.
All right. Well, now I know about Dred Scott. There you go.
Anyways, moving on along. This day in history, the year 1948, something close to Dustin's heart, the U.S. Congress passes Public Law 80-577, which permanently establishes the Civil Air Patrol as an auxiliary of the United States Air Force.
Hooray! Yay!
Yeah, Civil Air Patrol had actually been founded back in 1941, 6 days before Pearl Harbor.
Oh, shit.
And, yeah. Officers were authorized to wear U.S. lapel pins after they started getting shot down while bombing German subs. And this was when they finally got the official, like, fully official status. And what's also of note with, you know, 1948, that's the same year the Air Force actually became an independent branch.
So they wanted to have their young people able to go into their ranks as soon as possible then.
It's the cadet program is only one of the parts of Civil Air Patrol. It's not even the main thing.
I remember you talked about them before, saying that they were kind of like the Boy Scouts in your area. In a little bit of a way.
That is the cadet program is kind of like a cross between Boy Scouts and ROTC.
Hmm.
Oh, I was going to say, are they like the National Guard of the Air Force?
Or? No, that's the Air National Guard.
Okay.
The Air Guard. But
it's complicated.
Civil Air Patrol also has aerospace education and
my tiny
emergency services missions. And the emergency services part involves a lot of search and rescue, disaster relief, counter-narcotic operations, and stuff like that.
So like the National Guard.
But free. Well, a lot cheaper. Unpaid volunteers who fly small, cheap planes.
Okay.
And live all over the place. Yeah.
And help bomb subs.
That was with 1948, Civil Air Patrol was officially a benevolent, unarmed organization. Oh. So the only time when you can have firearms involved with Civil Air Patrol is if you are a police officer who is also a member of Civil Air Patrol and required by law in your state to be armed, and you're not on a military base, because then
they
you can't.
They weren't bombing. They were scouting for subs?
In 1948, it was ruled that Civil Air Patrol could not do any...
I got this. We're caught up now. Yes. Anyway, so yeah, 1948.
Yep.
See how I got to Dustin to do my whole segment there? This is
that
awesome.
Was pretty good, right? Good job, Wesley.
Yeah. I'm a slide thinker.
That one into home.
My tiny
shaking
male brain
your head, Dustin.
All right. And so let's go ahead and dust off the degree. This time we're going to talk about miracles.
Oh.
You should make a dusting noise.
Webster's Dictionary defines miracles as, one, an extraordinary event manifesting divine intervention in human affairs, two, an extremely outstanding or unusual event, thing, or accomplishment, or three, this is specific to Christian Science, a divinely natural phenomenon experienced humanly as the fulfillment of spiritual law. So,
like double rainbows?
No, more like being healed of a disease that wasn't really ever real, since they believe that disease was not real.
So that's not a good example at all.
No, no. So you'll often hear people describing something as miraculous using definition two, just that it was amazing. But generally, when people talk about miracles, they mean that there was divine intervention. So definition one. And now in Christian circles, you will frequently hear people talk about little miracles, like God helping them find a parking space in a crowded parking lot, or helping them find their keys that they couldn't otherwise find.
And double rainbows.
Yeah, yeah.
That's where they fit.
There we go.
But this is just trivial bullshit and simple probability. When people are really talking about miracles, they're talking about matters of life and death, and they are saying that the person survived because of God. It's almost excusable when it's really just ignorance, such as when my birth was declared miraculous due to the lack of medical data on the fertility and birth defect rates for cancer survivors. But with what we know now, my birth wasn't a miracle. It was just less probable than anyone else's. And I'll let you in on a little secret. If there's anything that the 4 billion years of life on Earth has taught us, it's that reproduction, under any circumstances, is not only not miraculous, it's to be expected.
So to quote Jurassic Park,
you're pregnant.
To quote Jurassic Park, life will find a way.
Yes, yes. Someone getting pregnant is never a miracle. Having a baby is never a miracle.
What if you're in a swimming pool and a guy comes in it?
Not a miracle.
Oh, that would be so
and probably not even real.
A toilet seat or a swimming pool pregnancy would be awesome.
So there is a point where miracle claims do get downright insulting. And that's when things go right. And the less probable and the more important the success is, the more the person responsible deserves the credit. One of my nieces survived a car accident not too long ago where the car she was riding in, it's actually her car, crashed into a tree at 90 miles per hour.
Wow.
The car was totaled, but no one was seriously hurt. Some family members called this a miracle and they praised God when they should have been writing thank you letters to the engineers at Volvo who designed a car that saved those four kids' lives.
Fucking hell.
And the simple fact that the car accident happened at all, and that most of the time with car accidents, most people aren't that lucky, especially when they're in vehicles. And there's actually a nice little correlation here. If they aren't doing everything right, they're not going to be lucky. And if they're in a vehicle that isn't very well designed, they aren't going to be lucky. And if there's ever miracles with car accidents, the drunk driver would always be the one who dies, not the one who almost always survives. And this would have looked a lot more like a miracle if the car had spontaneously died and come to a safe stop, allowing the police to apprehend the driver and then start up without incident when anyone else got behind the wheel, thus preventing the totaling of her car.
Yeah. Or magic potholes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
God sure does let a lot of shit just happen and then, you know, takes credit for a lot of, lucky little bits.
Then there's always stories like the people who were late to work at their jobs at the World Trade Center on September 11, 2001, and people who miss flights that crash, and people who survive natural disasters saying that their survival was a miracle.
No, you're just tardy.
How fucking arrogant would you have to be to think that your God, who you believe is the master of the universe, thought it important to save you, but not hundreds or thousands of other people who died?
Yeah, that really is disgusting.
When people say something is a miracle and they praise God, it's one of the many, many forms of Christian pseudo-humility. They get to talk about how good their connection is with the Most High, and they don't actually have to bother giving credit to where it's due, whether that's to the doctor who saved your fucking life, the engineer who designed the thing that saved your life, or, heck, even random chance, or even to just simply admit that you don't know how it worked, because you'd rather think you're special than to actually find out what happened.
Yeah.
Ah, goddamn.
So, Dustin.
Yes, ma'am.
You used to be called a miracle baby.
Yep. Yep.
You're, how do you feel about that? You seem to have some anger.
It put a lot of pressure on me.
I bet it did.
A lot of pressure. When you grow up believing that you're a miracle, then obviously your existence is a miracle, then obviously God must have some special plan for you.
He did have you leave the fold.
And then as a result of that, I ended up racking up $50,000 in student loan, racking up 1.5 useless degrees.
If you hadn't been called a miracle baby, do you think that you would have still felt the calling to go to seminary school? Do you think
no?
That might have been no. lessened or
given what his siblings have done, aka leave the church way sooner, yeah. He probably followed them in their footsteps earlier.
Yeah, I really don't think I would have felt a calling if I hadn't thought God had a special plan just for me.
Man.
Well, I think you're special. I love you more than God.
Well, and see,
because God doesn't love you because he doesn't exist.
People thought I was very special. Now that we have data on what happens after somebody has cancer and survives, I'm not special. I'm ordinary. And it's awesome to be ordinary.
Yes, it is awesome because so many people were able to have children after it was basically deemed impossible. So yay for that.
Also, and it's also really cool to know that I'm one of the data points that helped let people know that they could have families
after
cancer.
It is always good to be part of the data set.
Yeah.
Oh, man, that is true.
Yeah, yeah. All right, let's go ahead and take our first break, and then we'll be back with news. Atheist Nomads is proudly brought to you by Archway Hosting. Check out their low-price, full-featured hosting solutions at archwayhosting.com. That's A-R-C-H-W-A-Y hosting.com.
Hey, we're also brought to you by listeners just like you. Find out how you can become a patron at patreon.com/atheistnomads. That's patreon.com/atheistnomads.
Before we get into the bigger stories, there's a formerly Christian metal band.
Yeah, the Order of Elijah, metalcore.
Metalcore, yeah. Christian.
Well, they were Christian with a Christian label, and then a couple years ago, they switched to a secular label. And now the lead singer has come out as an atheist.
Yeah, they're pretty much all really distancing themselves from what was pretty much their entire livelihood, really. I mean,
mm-hmm.
So
is the, holy shit. I don't know, are they all non-believers, or was it that they've just become bored with that niche?
The lead singer explicitly came out as an atheist.
Okay. He definitely did. He Shannon Lowe definitely came out as an atheist. He actually had a write-up on the Friendly Atheist with Emmett. Mm-hmm. And yeah, they're basically leaving it.
And he told Emmett that his band members were supportive.
Yeah.
Oh, that's nice.
Doesn't mean they're also atheists, but
that's okay.
Probably not still Christian.
Yeah.
Totes.
Yeah,
he's pretty metal.
I've been chatting with him. He seems like a pretty damn good guy. So
nice.
Oh, I kind of imagine like the scene in Metalocalypse where the one guy is like trying to find religion and he goes through all the stuff and He's like, it's all bull crap.
All right. Awesome. Now,
on to the real news,
yes,
right?
Cardinal Robert Serra was the keynote speaker at the D.C. National Catholic Prayer Breakfast. He's a really high-up person in the Vatican. And there was a lot of members of Congress present, including Speaker Paul Ryan. Hmm. And while he was there, he said that, and I quote, "The death of God results in the burial of good, beauty, love, and truth. Good becomes evil, beauty is ugly, love becomes the satisfaction of sexual primal instincts, and truths are all relative. So all manner of immorality is not only accepted and tolerated today in advanced societies, but even promoted as a social good. The result is hostility to Christians and increasingly religious persecution."
Oh, God, there's that persecution complex again.
Uh-huh. "Nowhere is this clearer than in the threat the societies are visiting on the family through a demonic gender ideology, a deadly impulse that is being experienced in a world increasingly cut off from God through ideological colonialism." And he also said, "The rupture of the foundational relationships of someone's life through separation, divorce, or distorted impositions of the family, such as cohabitation and same-sex unions, is a deep wound that causes the heart to self-giving love unto death, or that closes the heart to self-giving love unto death, and even leads to cynicism and despair."
Oh, no, not cynicism.
"Those situations cause damage to little children through inflicting upon them a deep existential doubt about love. They are a scandal, a stumbling block that prevents the most vulnerable from being in such love, and a crushing burden that can prevent them from opening to the full power of the gospel." And then one final line from him: "Sadly, the advent of artificial reproductive technologies, surrogacy, so-called homosexual marriage, and other evils of gender ideology will inflict even more wounds in the midst of the generations we live with."
Whew.
Right. Wow, that was a whole lot of stuff that was not fun to say.
So yeah. So he went from like half asshole to full asshole with just that last line.
Yeah.
Yeah, because obviously if you can't have children, you weren't meant to have children, and that's part of God's plan.
And
your misery as a result of it will open you up to God's love, which is the only true love.
Mm-hmm.
Because apparently there's no other kind of love. That's what I got out of this, was this guy has never been loved by somebody. Like, what, did your dad kick your puppy when you were a kid or something?
He's been loved many times, and I'm sure they're all under 12 years old.
Oh. Ooh.
And
relevant.
Lauren, apparently, according to him, because we cohabitated before marriage.
Oh, so sinful.
Yep. We have deep wounds that have closed the heart to self-giving love and to death.
Think of our children's.
And that
think of our puppies.
That we have cynicism and despair, so, or at least soon will.
So you don't,
won't know the
you don't
love
have
of God.
Self-giving love anymore? All you need to do is masturbate frequently and you'll get that back.
Or, yep. You know, have chocolate and ice cream, which I have been denying myself an awful lot lately. So maybe that has something to do with it. I don't know.
But man, this asshat, he never came out and said.
He does have an asshat, doesn't he? Look, it does look kind of like an orange butt.
He never came out and said trans, but like what he was really getting at.
Oh, those gays.
Well, gender ideology is a way of saying
trans. Yeah. That trans people are killing God. That
good.
Gays are killing God.
Good.
That us cohabitating peoples are.
Fuck good.
Basically, anybody that's not getting married to have kids and is actually able to have kids is evil.
Yeah,
I know a lot of people who'd like to argue with that. What sucks is that he was spewing the stuff at our Congress people who were listening to it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to do my best Neil deGrasse Tyson face.
Yeah, yeah, and
you have to make it so your whole neck and chin, yep, go into one.
Present in this, at this prayer breakfast, was the third highest ranking person in our government.
Yeah, but we all know he's crazy.
Next in line after the president and vice president.
He's cray-cray.
And a possible dark horse into the president, into the GOP nomination. Hey, the GOP can just yeah. put in anybody they want to as a nomination. They don't have right. to have Trump.
It's really sad that I actually want them to put in somebody reasonable, like Mitt Romney or something.
Is it scary to say that Mitt is reasonable? Or Ryan, for that matter?
Oh, actually, secretly, I kind of hope Trump gets elected so that Dustin and I can move to New Zealand or Costa Rica. That's the plan, so I'm like, fingers crossed.
It's a thought. I would say it's a thought. I do have some distant relatives in New Zealand who have the family's royal tapestries.
Oh.
He has royal tapestries in his family. I have coal.
All right. So sticking with things that Paul Ryan was witness to, the U.S. House of Representatives unanimously passed H.R. That was a terrible segue. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I am so sorry. I've been trying, and you know, after 148 episodes, I still can't do a decent segue. God damn.
That's why I do it with noises. Beep, boop.
The U.S. House of Representatives unanimously passed H.R. 1150, which amends the International Religious Freedom Act of 1998. This act requires that infringements on people's religious freedom have to be included in the human rights report that gets submitted to Congress.
Okay.
So far, so good.
Mm-hmm.
And there is some good, and of course some bad in these changes, but let's start with the good. It says that, and I quote, the freedom of thought, conscience, and religion is understood to protect theistic and non-theistic beliefs, as well as the right not to profess or practice any religion.
Nice.
So countries who violate that would get put on the Human Rights Report as bad.
So most of Africa.
And the Middle East. Parts of Asia.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Parts of South and Central
America. Protect them, atheists.
Now,
and agnostics.
It also said... And again, I quote, though not confined to a particular region or regime, religious persecution and their specific targeting of non-theists, humanists, and atheists because of their beliefs is often particularly widespread, systematic, and heinous under totalitarian governments. And, this is also still in the good. under totalitarian governments and in countries with militant, politicized religious majorities and in regions where non-state actors exercise significant political power and influence. So, still very good. The bad is that it also protects male circumcision and ritualistic slaughter. This means that the U.S. will only consider genital mutilation to be a protected religious act if it's a penis that's getting cut. Something that's finally getting a critical look, albeit only in Nordic countries. And this also means that laws meant to reduce the suffering that food animals endure thanks to millennia-old cultural practices, namely halal and kosher, where the animal has to be alive when its throat gets slit, would get you and your country on the U.S.'s naughty list.
Hmm. So where does FJM, female genital mutilation, sit on this?
Oh, that's been a human rights violation for a long time, but still allowed to do it to the men. Hmm. Which, yeah.
Yeah.
I have issues with.
I want my half inch back.
Ditto.
No opinion on the matter. No, I do have a strong opinion, actually, but yeah.
So it's nice that they threw a bone to non-believers.
I like that they did include the explanation that they have been mm-hmm. Targeted and the word heinous was used, because in some of the we are constantly having to throw out warnings where if people are in a country where atheism is considered a crime, mm-hmm. you know, please be careful with with how you download this program, because it's not worth your life to listen to us joke around about this stuff.
Yeah.
Tails, agnostic. It is an agnostic operating system, meaning it doesn't know or remember anything you do, and it automatically puts you on Tor, so you get protection for downloading things like the Atheist Nomads.
Yeah, get yourself a USB key and go into your BIOS and set the USB key as your default drive and your boot drive and use that shit.
And also puts you on the federal watch list.
Yeah, yeah. We have talked about and linked to it, so we are probably already on that list.
Mm.
Sucks for Wesley since he has a government job.
Meh. I am the man. Fuck him.
But it really sucks, though, that they are protecting circumcision and ritualistic slaughter.
I thought the animal slaughter is a bit much, but kosher is such a huge deal in the in government here, even though the Jewish population in the United States is so small.
Well, that's because there's so many Christians in the government, and they, you know, fucking worship the ground that Israel walks on and can't wait to see the apocalypse happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but halal meat?
Well, yeah, they have to, you know.
I mean, you have to, yeah.
You got
to
keep the Jewish people happy.
And you can't just say kosher.
No, there's big-ass rules to be kosher or not.
Mm-hmm. And one of them has to be that the animal is alive when it's hung up and its neck is slit.
Fucked up.
There are worse kosher ways to go.
Not really.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so think about that when you eat those kosher hot dogs.
Yeah.
Yeah!
Hebrew National.
This summer.
Suffering meat.
I want lips and assholes in my hot dogs. Fuck that kosher shit.
Oh, so you want McDonald's hot dogs?
Well, Burger King hot dogs.
Yeah, oh, McDonald's doesn't have hot dogs.
No. I'm silly. Sonic. Does. Or Bologna's.
Hey, I like fried Bologna sandwiches.
Mm. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, last year, Ryan Bell was invited by a psychology professor at his alma mater, Pacific Union College, the Adventist College in Northern California. And within a few days before his scheduled appearance, the college president, Dr. Heather Knight, canceled the event.
Whoa.
What?
The professor who had made the invitation, Aubin Fulton, has since said that he is getting fired over inviting a prominent ex-Adventist atheist and friend of the show to the campus.
Twice over.
Knight, he's getting fired for just doing the invitation?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, wow.
Paul, Ryan didn't even get to speak there, so.
Yeah, and Knight claimed that she canceled it because she only became aware of it 4 days before it was supposed to happen, and she's going to be out of town that weekend, so she wouldn't be able to monitor it closely enough.
I'm sure she monitors every event ever on campus.
And I'm sure that she would be right there with like a giant red button to turn off the lights and the microphones in case, you know, Ryan said something that she didn't want to hear.
Right.
So Dr. Fulton said on Facebook that he's getting fired. This has not been confirmed by any other sources. Knight has denied explicitly that she's firing anyone. However, college presidents don't have the authority to fire tenured professors. That requires the board. So if he is getting fired, it's not her that's doing it. It's the Pacific Union Conference president.
Ooh.
Her boss. And so this still prompted a 60-student march with these students demanding a town hall-style meeting with Knight.
Nice.
And she had already previously set up an academic freedom task force, and she has now said that she's considering a proposal to set up an academic freedom advisory council that would hear academic freedom complaints and concerns and be able to advise the president and her cabinet on those issues. Since there is a rather rapidly growing opinion on the campus that academic freedom, well, isn't really much of a thing. Several professors actually have resigned or retired in recent years over this topic.
No shit.
See, this comes up a lot in the Mormon colleges, the BYU, BYU Idaho, BYU Hawaii. What they basically come to say is, you know, fuck your rights as students. You're paying a lot of money to be here, and we're a private religious school. Deal with it.
Yeah.
And the students are like, shit, got no choice. Okay.
Yeah, and for the Adventists, they try to walk a fine line between academic freedom, which is important to make sure they can maintain accreditation, because Adventist colleges are all accredited.
Mm-hmm.
And they have to they really need and want to keep that accreditation. And maintaining the goodwill of the alumni and church membership that funds them.
Yeah.
And the pastors that sit on their board.
So they got to keep the old people happy too.
Yep.
Yep.
Old conservatives who don't want professors that are okay with homosexuality and inviting an atheist who used to be a well-known pastor onto campus.
Right.
Of their religion. I mean,
asking for some serious questioning by students if you bring on somebody like that.
You know, if they had a former Southern Baptist atheist come in, I think they would be way more okay with that than a Seventh Day because, well, he was them.
Now, Ryan Bell,
mm-hmm.
he's the one that decided to be atheist for a year.
Yeah.
Did the year without God.
Year without God, and then decided that was the right way to go after all.
Yeah.
Yep.
Cool.
So he's showing a path that, you know, you can be live without God and be good without God and all that other bullshit.
all that other bullshit that we try to represent every day.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. So, yeah, I could see where he would be a extreme threat, actually. So.
Oh, yeah, I totally agree. But this is this will be interesting if they actually, like, I didn't report on bother bringing up Bell being his invitation being canceled because that wasn't surprising. But the fact that they might be firing a professor over this, that's big.
Yeah, that's a little more surprising.
Especially since in California, the Adventist colleges, well, West Coast in general, Adventist colleges are under a close watch by the Western Association of Colleges and Universities, the accrediting body. La Sierra University got an accreditation audit over complaints of academic freedom being violated. And is on probation. So their sister college is on probation and they pull this shit.
Yeah.
All right, we are going to take another break and then we'll be back with world news. We love hearing from our listeners. You can email us at contact@atheistnomads.com, tweet us @atheistnomads, send us a message on our Facebook page at facebook.com/atheistnomads, or better yet, call us and leave us a message at 541-203-0666. We might even play it on the show. You can also help us out by leaving us a review on iTunes, Stitcher, or your podcast directory of choice. Last year, the Mexican Supreme Court ruled that bans on same-sex marriages are unconstitutional, which means that there is binding legal precedent, but Supreme Court rulings in Mexico do not compel changes in the law or nullify laws. So they just apply to the parties in the case and require lower judges to follow suit if somebody else files suit.
Ah.
So if you don't live in Mexico City or one of the four states that have already made same-sex marriage legal and you are gay and want to get married, you still have to go to court and have a judge order officials to issue a license.
Mm. Well, so, that's kind of a pain in the butt.
Mexico is way more about states' rights than they are about federal level.
Their courts just aren't as powerful.
Huh. Okay.
So their Supreme Court has a much lower
authority level. Not quite as supreme as we have here.
Yeah, because here we go with the principle of three equal branches. They don't. That's kind of a uniquely American thing.
Hmm.
So
America, yeah.
Now President Enrique Peña Nieto is proposing constitutional reform to legalize same-sex marriage once and for all, saying, "I do this with the conviction that the Mexican state must prevent discrimination for any motive and ensure equal rights to all."
Woo!
Well, that's a good
job,
at least.
Presidente.
I mean, I've heard he's quite the asshole from one of our readers, but listeners, but hey, I guess at least this is good.
Yeah. This is, it's a good move. And you know, realistically, he's probably just seeing it as it's creating a mess for the courts. Nobody wants hundreds of thousands of extra needless lawsuits being filed and wasting time for judges. So go ahead and just get it over with. And, you know, hopefully he actually is standing up for equal rights and not just doing what's expedient. But the Catholic Church, which Mexico has the world's second largest Catholic population.
Behind what? Like Brazil?
Probably would be Brazil, yeah. They are strongly opposed to this and absolutely disagree with him. That came from the spokesman for the Archdiocese of Mexico.
Wow.
He said, "We deeply regret that the president presented this initiative," adding that it was unnecessary following the top court's ruling. Yeah, unnecessary unless... It would be unnecessary if it didn't require a court intervention every single time.
Well, if Colombia can do it, Mexico can do it too. So go Presidente.
Uh-huh. Yeah, they would become the fifth Latin American country to legalize same-sex marriage since yeah, four South American countries already have.
All right.
Yeah. All right, moving along. Iran's morality police are cracking down on women who are not wearing headscarves in pictures on social media. At least eight women have been arrested so far. And one former model who posed in bridal gowns with bleached hair on Instagram was questioned on TV by prosecutors. Two prosecutors. And she claimed that the modeling was a bitter experience and warned women not to participate in the illegal industry since, and I quote, "You can be certain that no man would want to marry a model whose fame has come by losing her honor."
I would.
So she's a model against her will? Because that's what that sounds like.
It sounds more like they forced her to say that to avoid going to jail.
Yeah, that too.
The statements were made against her will.
I'm assuming that they're just calling any woman that's showing herself on Instagram as a model.
Yeah, that's kind of what it sounded like.
Yeah.
Yeah, they did also arrest a blogger who has been running a publishing tool called the Persian Blog. Apparently has been posting some of these pictures.
Oh, well, you certainly shouldn't be reposting pictures that without somebody's permission. But that's beside the point. It's the headscarf thing. It's antiquated, and Iran should go back to the 70s when women had a little bit more equality and power and were going to school and were wearing skirts and
wearing pants
if they wanted to.
Yeah,
I mean, I understand that if women were allowed to wear, say, any Western style clothing that they wanted, a majority of them would probably stick with traditional wear because that's also what they believe. They believe that, you know, not wearing a scarf is an insult, you know, to do. But there's a lot of women who would like that choice, at least.
Yeah. So in Iran, it was 1979 revolution. Women were forced to cover up.
Yeah.
In Jordan, through the 1980s, women wore Western clothing, didn't wear headscarves. And it ended up being something happened in the 90s and 2000s where the culture had a backlash. There wasn't any legislation behind it, but women started choosing, or their male family members started imposing on them, covering up more.
Well,
but it should definitely be a choice.
That would be nice.
And A Pakistani trans activist was shot several times by, most likely by a gang that tries to extort money out of trans people and or force them to make porn. She was taken to the hospital.
That sounds like a James Bond villain. Right there. That's evil.
It's a Pakistani gang. She was taken to the hospital where she had to wait for 4 hours for treatment.
Right.
After several gunshot wounds, because the ICU refused to take her, and the male and female wards kept sending her to the other ward.
Oh my gosh.
So, run up the stairs? No, go downstairs. Run downstairs? No, go upstairs. Run upstairs? No, go downstairs. They went through that over and over until the hospital finally set up a private room. And then she finally started to receive treatment.
Holy shit.
And this was in a foreign hospital, too.
Jeez.
Well, for one, why the hell do they have male and female wards? It's a fucking hospital.
Well, because Muslim.
Well, yeah, in Muslim countries, that's a big deal. You don't...
But...
I mean...
It's a hospital.
It's a privacy thing.
That's what curtains are for.
No.
Even, I mean, yeah, we have different rooms, but if it's an open room with just screens separating, there's women and men's areas. You don't have a male patient right next to a female patient right next to another male patient. That's...
You might see the outline of a female body. Come on.
Or, she might get molested or something by people who are able to move around a little bit better, or
well, if you have that problem, you have a problem in your society to begin
we
with.
We have that.
I'm not going to debate
that. Not common.
That's because we've moved to single room occupancy.
Yeah.
You know, I'm saying back in, you know.
Yeah. Okay.
Field hospitals, yeah, there's a male and a female. That's why prisons are separated. And all sorts of stuff. A lot of women don't feel comfortable with men being around when they are not feeling up to defending themselves.
Yeah, one thing I do find that I am a bit concerned with this particular case is what kind of care she's going to be getting now.
Yeah, now that she's finally gotten a place.
Yeah, if she's not fully accepted into a ward, then is she going to be getting the same rate and rotation of care as everyone else? Yeah, I kind of doubt it.
Highly doubt it.
Yeah. And it's not like they were even having to run around outside of normal business hours. They got there at 9:30 in the morning.
Shit.
Took 1:30 to get her a bed.
Wow.
Well, I'm just happy she's not dead.
Yep.
Yeah. At least as far as we know. This article is a day old as of the date of recording.
Well, I'm just happy she's not dead yet.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Fuck. All right, we're going to take our last break, and then we'll be back with science.
As a listener of the show, I'm going to assume you love my sexy vocal stylings. If you love the rest of the show as much as my voice, consider giving us the resources we desperately need to purchase quality cocaine and Red Bull. We make it super easy to make a one-time donation or to support us on a per-episode, monthly, or even annual basis using PayPal or Patreon. Find out more at atheistnomads.com. Use the links on the right side of the page. $1 an episode is all we ask.
All right, and we are back with science and technology. Yay. One little shout out to all of you in the Puget Sound, Cascadia area. Watch out. Those earthquakes are continuing, and everybody is watching to see if something interesting will happen. Probably not. It's probably the magma chambers just filling up, but it has been really fun for volcanists who are watching that part of the country. So, yeah, shout out to the volcanoes. Yeah.
People that like Star Trek? Volcanus?
Oh, ha!
So, which volcano?
At this point, all of them. We're talking Mount Rainier. We're talking Mount St. Helens, Mount Adams.
Yeah.
They've all been shaken.
Oh.
Yep, they're all earthquaking it up right now. And it's pretty awesome to watch. You can watch it from, I can't remember the institution's name, but they're basically the ones in charge. Pacific Northwest earthquake monitoring.
Okay.
It's fun.
Hmm.
I'm not really afraid of St. Helens. I mean, there's not much of it left, but Rainier, man, that could fuck everybody shit up.
Oh, yeah.
It'd be awesome. I mean, it wouldn't be awesome.
Hey, you guys are most likely in the direct line of sight.
I totally understand that. And uh-huh. I have to say, if you're going to go down in a blaze of glory, a volcano is one hell of a way to do it.
So we would most likely lose the sun for... Okay, this is Boise. With the inversions we get, we'd probably lose the sun for a few months. But Puyallup might not exist.
Yeah. So much for moving. Okay, so as of yesterday, March 25th, National Towel Day, Geek Pride Day, was made in honor of Douglas Adams. Douglas Adams is the writer of Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, a rather famous science fiction comedy. And there was a little piece of extraterrestrial biology that exists in that book that is so insanely useful that it proves that God cannot exist. It's a fantastic piece. I suggest everybody go back and read that. It is the piece that, of course, introduces the babelfish, or babelfish. It is a small yellow fish that fits into one's ear and converts all languages into the owner's own language, becoming the universal instant translator.
Hmm.
This is classic. It's in both the old BBC show. It's also in the new Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy with Mos Def and, you know, those guys. It's awesome. What we want has been something that science fiction has been toting for a long time and something that we would love to have. Well, it's finally here. It's a $130 earpiece duo. I want to specify that this is to be used by two people that translates the spoken word from one person into the owner's own preference.
I would buy this.
Nice.
I want to hella buy this. Oh, yeah. So an English tourist in France hears the English word spoken into his or her ear, moments after they are spoken by a French counterpart who's wearing the other pilot.
Hmm.
Pilot is the name of the thing. I don't know why they didn't go with babelfish.
Trademark issues.
They lost out on that totally. One. Right now it works with English, French, and Spanish and Italian. I have a feeling, though, that this is just the first step, that this is going to explode, and that pretty soon everybody who travels is going to have one of these. Mm-hmm. If not these, then something very similar to it. Considering how well Google Translate has been shown to work for business people and for tourists.
Skype has added translation, on-the-fly translation capability.
That stuff used to be damn near impossible, and now we can fit it into our own ears. And it's really, really cool. So hopefully we'll all be able to have our own little useful God-defined device in our heads here pretty soon.
Nice.
Sadly, it does not come in yellow. It comes in black, white, and red. So again, somebody out there needs to come up with a babelfish and make it yellow and shaped like a little rubber fish, and I will buy that so hard. Even though I'm surrounded by people who speak English.
Uh-huh. And also if you go to, say, France... Odds are the person you'd be talking to would rather just speak to you in English than use the
device. Not the point. I'd much rather just have them use it. Just like, nope, put it in your ear. Do it. Do it. Ah!
You'd need to go to a French-speaking country in Africa.
Why even do that?
How about Belgium?
I mean, you could wear it and just turn yours to French and learn a new language.
Belgium, they all speak English too.
Actually, that is a really good idea, Wesley, turning it into a different language, and then you, whenever somebody's speaking English, you would hear it in your ear as the language you're trying to learn.
Yeah.
Genius! It sounds like that they should send us one so that we can then sponsor.
Oh, yeah, totally.
Sponsor it, right?
Yeah.
We'd love to give a review on the pilot. Yeah. So if anybody has an in with the pilot program, let us know, and we'll do that for you.
And we have been hearing from foreign listeners recently, so we could probably get one of them to help us test it out.
Absolutely. Let's see here. Oh, now we're going to go shift away from the technology and go back into the science.
All right.
Over 4 billion years ago, our rocky planet was covered in a thick shield of ice, frozen, holding no signs of life. At that point, however, our young sun was going crazy, throwing off solar radiation like a disco ball in Chernobyl. In this paper, out of Nature Geoscience, NASA scientists outlined the possibility that this frantic solar activity is what allowed frozen Earth to begin gathering greenhouse gases, which set the stage for liquid water, and thus life, to cover the planet. The transition between ice and water 4 billion years ago has puzzled scientists for years, but the sun's solar flares could help the astronomers search for potential life-friendly systems in our search for habitable planets.
Very nice.
Because, as everybody knows, the further out you're looking, the further back in time you're looking. So if they go back far enough and there's a young star with some rocky planets that are ice-covered, who knows? Perhaps they could be liquid water by the time we are able to send out a faster probe or...
Yeah. To, you know, get there and...
Kill our planet and need to find a new one.
But by which point, there'd be so many generations that have lived on that ship that they would probably just be adapted to and happy with living on the ship.
Nah, you'll always want to have a planet for resources.
We saw that on Voyager. You a steal raw resources from uninhabited planets.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's it for science.
All right.
You also saw that on WALL-E.
WALL-E. I also saw a lot of fat people.
Yeah, well, they're used to the ship. Which has come true.
So we got some feedback. We got one today on YouTube, today being Tuesday while recording, recording, from Mark. This is regarding episode 133. He said, "Now I want Waffle House."
Fuck yeah.
What is Waffle House?
Eli Bosnick was talking about Waffle House.
Oh, okay. So that's a chain, right? That's like IHOP?
Yeah.
We have IHOP and Denny's.
Yeah. Oh, no. Waffle House is really amazing and really disgusting.
We also have the original Pancake House, which has coconut syrup, which is like one of the best things I've ever had.
No, fuck
All right, coconut. Rather than getting back into that topic again...
fuck coconut, what?
I hate coconut.
We got two about episode 146, our last news episode. First one was from Enrique via Facebook. "I'm new to your podcast, just listened to the last two and enjoyed them very much. Just rated the app as instructed with a 5-star.
Woohoo!
I'm from Mexico and think your description of Guadalupe was very accurate.
Woo!
I just hope that in 100 years we're secular and not Marist. The last three popes have heavily supported this myth, probably because they have to keep their credulous bases. We don't keep stats here like the Pew Review, but I can happily inform that in my daily life, I've seen secular humanism grow exponentially. Another piece of information is that most churches built on hills were constructed over pre-Hispanic temples or pyramids. Thanks for your great job."
I totally believe about the ruins thing. That, I mean, you can't throw a stone without hitting something that is ancient and awesome.
Well, and that's actually true about...
In fact, the stone you threw was probably ancient and awesome.
Damn it.
Yeah, you knew I was going to go there.
But that's also true with Europe, the Middle East. High places were always a place for pagan religions to build altars and to have their services and build their temples. And when a new religion takes over, one of the first things they do is they bulldoze. Well, they didn't have bulldozers then. They tear down the existing religious structure and they put up their own.
Sure.
One really good example on this would be the Hagia Sophia in Istanbul, which started out as a church and is now a mosque.
Well, Rocco was really happy with that.
And also on the same topic from Gerardo via email. Hey, guys, as usual, things to say. I love your show. Listener for years, yada, yada, yada. Also, you sirs have excellent taste on beer. Once you mentioned triple Carmelite, I knew you knew what you were talking about. Yes, thank you. I would love to have another bottle of that, maybe here someday soon. So just writing because as extensively as you might have researched about Virgin of Guadalupe, I wonder if you ever heard of Fray Servando Teresa de Mayer. He's actually one of the few prominent characters from the city I was born, Monterrey, Mexico. Quite an adventurous life and a radically liberal priest.
Oh, cool.
He's also famous because he preached a sermon on the very Guadalupe's sanctuary, where he basically suggested a whole different timeline for the painting's origin, went deep into the roots of the indigenous tradition that might relate with Guadalupe and the holiness of the place the church was ultimately built. And of course, Servando was scolded by the Catholic Church and sent to exile in Spain. They just didn't seem to get punishment right, don't they? Not for heresy, neither for child abuse. I thought you might find this historical bit interesting. Here's more Wikipedia information on this guy. And the links will be down in the feedback section on the show notes. I read through that. And
that's cool.
Pretty fascinating. He started saying that, one of the apostles went to Mexico.
Oh.
And took that painting with him.
Oh, because obviously the painting wasn't made up of roses or anything like that. It was it's a very beautiful painting.
Mm-hmm. And now, of course, his heretical idea, pretty hilarious, but doesn't really fit with the science that it fit the art of the time period in which it first appeared in the historical record.
I just want to give a little shout out to Monterrey. Yeah, that's awesome. Keep it up. Also, being exiled to Spain, I'm sorry, have you seen Valencia?
Nope.
Not that bad of a place to get it. It's like being exiled to the beaches of Australia. You turn around and you see it from the boat and you're like, damn, not bad.
Yeah.
75 degrees sunny weather at the middle of December. Well, anyway, that's just Valencia.
Yep.
From what I've heard.
All right.
Well, I would love to visit, so you know, Patreon. Woo! It's for research, people, obviously.
If you want to reach us, you can always email us at contact@atheistnomads.com. You can call us at 541-203-0666. Or if you're overseas, that would be +1 541-203-0666. Got to make sure we get the whole international thing in there.
Oh, sweet.
You could also hit us up on Facebook, facebook.com/atheistnomads, Twitter @atheistnomads. And everywhere else. We're all over the internet. We didn't get any new iTunes reviews, unfortunately. Please give us more. We need those. They help us with the rankings on iTunes so that more people will find the show. So if you like the show, you should want other people to also find the show so they can like it. So give us 5-star reviews.
And also, if you actually have something to say about the format, about the show, anything like that, let these guys know. You know, give them a heads up.
Yeah.
In order to get better, you need to have the criticism first.
Yep.
Unless you're like me, who just starts to cry, like bawling when you get criticized, even though like you don't mean to. It's very emotional.
Yeah. And one thing that's been interesting, just for a little tangent here with that, is podcasts that have women on them, you frequently hear them, well, occasionally hear them talk about how much shit they get about the female hosts.
Wah, wah.
We haven't gotten any of that.
Woo!
Yeah.
So I don't know if you guys are all awesome or if some of you are misogynists and are just afraid to send that to her husband.
Gee, you didn't make that any easier, did you? But anyway, yes, thank you.
And we also didn't get any new patrons. Patreon.com/atheistnomads, or you can support us on PayPal. Go to atheistnomads.com and look for the links on the right side of the page. Next week we'll be back with an interview.
Fucking hey.
All right.
Thank you for listening to another episode of Atheist Nomads. You can find show notes and contact information at atheistnomads.com. Follow us on Twitter at Atheist Nomads, and like us on Facebook at facebook.com/atheistnomads. Please subscribe to the show in iTunes, Stitcher, or your podcatcher of choice, and while you're there, feel free to leave us a review. Theme music is courtesy of Sturdy Fred. Until next time, this has been the Atheist Nomads.